was revealed to Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon his soul. Ramadan, 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 Ramadan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brothers and sisters, and welcome again, all viewers, to Ramadan Spirit America. I'm your host, Hamza Popal, and today I'm joined with Imam Karim Abu Zayd. We're going to be covering the topic of Laylatul Qadr, a night that we all understand is a very important night in the life of every Muslim, and a night that we try to take advantage of, or at least should try to take advantage of, being that we are not absolutely sure if this could be the last chance we have to see the night of decree or power. When it comes to the, well, first of all, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Imam Karim.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brother Hamza.
When it comes to the subject of Laylatul Qadr, or Qadr in general, there has been historically, I think, much confusion, especially when it comes to Qadr as a subject itself. There have been, you know, groups that have gone astray on the matter, sometimes very far astray. Could you shed some light on the subject of Qadr, or also Laylatul Qadr itself?
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah, wa ashadu an la ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. First of all, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, at the very beginning of the month, was given the glad tiding to his companions with respect to the arrival of the month, in the famous hadith when he said to them, جاءكم شهر مبارك شهر رمضان, a blessed month has come to you, is the month of Ramadan. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam went on, and then he singled out Laylatul Qadr out of the month, and he said about it, فيه ليلة, in this month there is one night, من حرم خيرها فهو محروم, whosoever is deprived from the goodness on this night, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may give a Muslim who is observing ibadah on this night, is indeed being deprived. And we already spoke before about the three golden chances which a Muslim have in Ramadan. مَنْ صَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا, whoever fasts the whole month out of iman, out of belief, and hoping to receive the reward, Allah will forgive all his previous sins. مَنْ قَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا, making qiyam throughout the month, imanan, believing, and ihtisaba, and hoping for the reward, Allah will forgive all his sins. There is only the third golden opportunity is exclusive to just one night of the month. من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه.
So how is a good way to take advantage? I mean, are the rituals specified to only qiyam, or can a Muslim take advantage of it through dua or through other means of worship?
Well, in general, you just have to continue what you've been doing throughout the month, hopefully.
Okay, so praying Taraweeh.
Yes, but you accelerate, because we need to learn that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has basically secluded himself completely from the world by practicing a ritual called i'tikaf, which is seclusion, where you go and actually live in the mosque, in the masajid, for the 10 nights, the last 10 nights of the month. And the reason why, because this night is hidden in these 10 nights of the month. So yeah, we do not know exactly which night it will be. We know that it is hidden in the last 10 nights of the month. Most probably the odd nights are the highest possibility, and even certain odd nights are the highest of the highest possibilities, the 23rd, the 25th, of course the 27th is the highest possibility. So Basically, if you just shoot for one of these possibilities, you're really gambling, and you may not coincide with it, and you actually may miss the actual night. Consequently, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has us, do i'tikaf. And if you're not going to do i'tikaf, just make sure that every single night of the last 10 nights of the month, you're engaged completely in ibadah. Whether Salatul Qiyam, whether the recitation of the Quran, whether making dua, whether making adhkar, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorifying and exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during these 10 nights is really what you need to do. So you can do variety of acts of worship, but in general, Salatul Qiyam, man qama ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا, meaning salah, that you actually pray Salatul Qiyam, and of course because you're in the masjid, you could pray more in the masjid بإذن الله تعالى.
Okay, so when it comes to i'tikaf, it's exclusive to the masjid. There, you can't find seclusion somewhere where it may be easier, because I know nowadays a lot of people practice that ritual. And so sometimes it's difficult to find your own seclusion. Sometimes you may be even tempted to talk with your brothers who are there. Not to say that that's necessarily bad, but it kind of interrupts.
Distractive.
Exactly.
Yeah. Al-i'tikaf has to be in a masjid.
Okay.
وَلَا تُبَاشِرُوهُنَّ وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ.
Okay.
Basically, a verse in out of the verses of Siyam in Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't have a relationship with one spouse while you are making i'tikaf in the masajid.
Okay, so specifically the masjid, okay.
Actually, we have the view of Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, that the only three masajid he can do i'tikaf to.
Oh, okay, so
the Masjid al-Haram, the Masjid al-Nabawi in Medina, and the Masjid al-Aqsa. Okay. But this is again one view. The majority of the views, or the majority of the jurists, they see any masjid where jama'ah is established. Okay. Salatul jama'ah is established. So that you do not have to go out of the state of seclusion, the state of i'tikaf, every time you want to observe a mandatory salah. So as long as Salatul Jama'ah, the mandatory Salah, is established in that masjid, he can stay there. Now once it comes to distractions and so forth, I think you need to set up your own style of i'tikaf that, you know, you're not open for that.
Okay.
And alhamdulillah, masajid these days do prepare, their facility in a way that you end up with some privacy. You end up with a little small tent out there. You end up with some privacy one way or another. But mashallah, you have to do i'tikaf in the masajid, not in your bedroom, not in your office, okay. Not in a hotel room.
Okay.
Yeah.
The night of power or the night of decree, I mean, just as I said, there's different, you know, terms for it. What are the relation of the of these terms? Are they related? Are they, what is the relevance of the terms?
Okay, so we mentioned that there is that night hidden in the last nights, 10 nights of the month.
Mm-hmm.
This night has a name. It's called Laylatul Qadr. Of course, we know what a night is. At least the duration of time, yani the famous view from sunset until Fajr.
Mm-hmm.
There is a view from Asr until Fajr. There is a view that the night begins there. But in general, we know what a night is. Now, the key word here is Al-Qadr. What does it mean, the word Al-Qadr? Al-Qadr means status. One of the, if you actually go through the meanings of the word al-Qadr, you can come up with eight meanings. But let's just take two for you know, the sake of getting stuff done here. Means a status. Inna anzalnahu fi laylat al-Qadr. We brought it down in the night of al-Qadr, in the night of status. Why it's called that? Because the night itself has a status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah created the day, Allah created the night, and He chose that night out of the nights to have a special status.
Yeah.
Like Jumu'ah, the day of Jumu'ah, out of the week. Like the day of Arafah, out of the year. وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَأَخْتَارُ. Your Lord created whatever He wills, whatever He wishes, whatever He wants. And He chooses from what He created to grant preference to. So one night out of the year, He given it special preference. So the night itself has a status, is majestic in the sight of the one who created the night.
And sorry, Sheikh, if we can, we do have a phone call coming in, no. And then inshallah we'll continue afterwards. Caller, if you can go ahead, state your name and the location you're calling from and your question. Assalamu alaikum. Hello? Okay, so I think that call has dropped.
So the night has status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. A sign of righteousness and piety in with respect to the believer, that you glorify, you exalt what Allah chose to have a status.
So give value to what Allah has
given value to what Allah has preferred.
Yeah.
Because we love what Allah loves. We glorify what Allah glorifies. You understand?
Yeah.
So now, also, the night is called the night of status, or the night of, or the majestic night. You have a phone call?
I don't think so.
Okay. A majestic night, because of the fact that those who observe ibadah in this night, they will have...
Sorry, and I guess actually we do have another call coming in, so we'll continue with the status of Laylatul Qadr. After we take this call, caller, go ahead and state your name and your question.
Assalamu alaikum, this is Ibrahim.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
I have a question on Laylatul Qadr, or inshallah during the night when I'm making dua. Do I have to be very specific for everything that I want to ask for, or can I, for example, just read a lot of Quran?
Okay, so specific dua is, that's a good question.
Jazakallahu khairan. We'll answer his question, inshallah, but let me just finish this point because I may lose my thought here.
Sure.
Those who observe ibadah on this night, as will, they gain status.
Okay.
And one of the best status is they receive a prolonged lifespan, not the actual years, but the quality of their lives. Laylatul Qadri khayrun min alf shahr. The night of Al-Qadr, with respect to those who observe ibadah on this night, is better than 1,000 months, meaning that a person will be written to have worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the virtue of worshipping Allah one night, which is the Laylatul Qadr. He will be written that he had worshipped Allah 83 plus 3.3 months.
See, and I've heard
so it's a prolonged life. And this is the status that you get if you glorify and exalt what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exalts and glorifies.
There's a, like in Tafsir Ibn Kathir, and I think among the other books of Tafsir, a story of a man from Bani Israel. I don't know if that's authentic or not, but he fought in the daytime for some, 1,000 months or more, or 1,000 years. I'm not sure the amount of time.
Yeah, the story is there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given the ummah just one night, 83. So you see that the lifespan of the nations before us were extended.
Sure.
We know that Adam alayhi salam lived for 1,000 years.
Yeah.
Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, his da'wah only was 950 years. وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فَلَبِثَ فِيهِمْ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ إِلَّا خَمْسِينَ عَامًا. But our lifespan, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم told us that the lifespan of my ummah, والحديث في سنن الترمذي, أعمار أمتي بين الستين والسبعين, from 60 to 70 years old.
Sure.
So our lifespan compared with the lifespan of the nations before us is very short. Is not even to compare.
So our opportunity is not compatible.
But subhanAllah, Allah has given us these opportunities in order to prolong our lives, not with fitan. You see, you're going to be written to be worshipping Allah 83 years straight without obedience, without disobedience. You see, if you have lived 83 years, you would disobey Allah in the 83 years for sure.
Yeah.
You would have used some of that time to sleep, some of the time to drink, some of the time to go to the doctor, some of the time to gossip, to backbite. Listen, you're going to be written 83 years just worshipping Allah non-stop. Non-stop. And this is the mercy of Allah showing in action to us on this night. So this is the first meaning of the word al-qadr. Al-qadr is a status that is in the sight of Allah. And it's in the sight of Allah also because Allah revealed His best speech. الله نزل أحسن الحديث. You see, Allah spoke so many things, and we believe, we affirm as Muslims, as believers, that Allah speaks, but He speaks in a way that suits His Majesty.
Sure.
We do not liken His way of speaking to our way of speaking. He speaks in a way that suits His Majesty, and it's not my job simply to find out how He speaks, but the Quran is the speech of Allah. Al-Quran, Kalamullah, is the speech of Allah. Mm-hmm. The revelation which we recite in Ramadan is Kalamullah. Now, this Quran was revealed on Laylatul Qadr. This is why also the night has a status, because Inna Anzalnahu, who here refers to Al-Quran, the revelation. The Quran which Muslims recite during the month of Ramadan, throughout the month, of course, and in Salatul Taraweeh and so forth. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatul qadr. Of course, a lot of the brothers and the sisters may be confused because sometimes they hear speakers say that the Quran was revealed in 23 years.
Mm-hmm.
So how is it revealed in laylatul qadr?
Through piecemeal, right? So okay.
In one night only. You see, the Quran has two descendances.
Mm-hmm.
The Quran was brought down twice. The first descending happened from the preserved tablet, Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz, which is where the Qadr is recorded, where everything is recorded. The Quran is part or was included in the Lawh al-Mahfuz. So now the Quran was taken down from the preserved tablet, which is in the seventh heaven, into the lower heaven in a house called Baytul Izzah,
mm-hmm.
the house of dignity, the house of glory. This happened on Laylat al-Qadr.
Okay, so that initial revelation from
that initial descending happened on this night.
Oh, okay.
So. And some other views, which is strong views, that the initiation of the second descendants, which has lasted 23 years, happened also in Laylatul Qadr.
Okay.
When Jibreel alayhi salam came down to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he came down to him, commanding him to read. He came down to him on Laylatul Qadr. So again, we covered
With the first revelation, you mean?
With Iqra, Laylatul Qadr, but then it lasted for 23 years.
Okay.
It kept going for 23 years plus couple of months. So now we explained the first meaning of the word Qadr. Inshallah, we're going to go into the second meaning, which is the relationship to the subject of Al-Qadr, which is the sixth article of faith. And we're going to explain this after we address the question of our brother who called, I believe, Brother Ibrahim. Mm-hmm. He's asking, should I make a specific dua? Should I recite the Quran? I guess that was his question, if you recall.
I think so. That's
right. What it was. Okay. Laylatul Qadr is a night when the supplications are accepted. The invocations are accepted. So when you make dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your dua. Now, dua Making dua can be of two types. We have dua al-thana wa dua al-haja. When we invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are two types of invocations which we can do. An invocation is called the invocation of praise, that you actually just praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is called dua.
Okay.
And the other type that you request a certain thing from Allah, that you name your need.
Can you do one without the other, or is it better to include both?
Actually, both is a lot better, that you actually begin with the praise and then your request.
Okay.
But if you don't have a specific request, because I don't want the brothers out there saying, you know what, alhamdulillah, I do not need anything, so I do not need to make dua tonight. No. You can then get engaged in the first type, the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best of praise is the praise using the words of Tawheed. You know, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Prophet Musa, peace be upon him, asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Allah, teach me words with which I can praise you that no one else ever used or ever praised you with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Prophet Musa alayhi salam, O Musa, say, La ilaha illallah. Say, there is no deity, object, created being worthy of my submission, of my worship, except Allah. Then Musa alayhi salatu wa salam said, O Allah, everyone says that. This is the universal declaration of monotheism, of Tawheed.
From every prophet.
From every prophet. Sure. And this is the shared aspect of the messengership between Rasulina, our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all his brothers before. And that is why we believe that all the messengers before us were Muslims. Mm-hmm. And the people who followed them were Muslims. Because that was the core item of the risalah, of the message of all these messengers before, like our message as well. The core aspect of our message is Tawheed, is La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. Al-Shahid is, here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is directing Musa alayhi salatu wa salam to praise him using Tawheed. Using Tawheed. وعنا حديث عبد الله بن عباس في صحيح الإمام البخاري قال صلى الله عليه وسلم the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says دعاء الكرب the supplication which one makes when he is distressed is look at this now so when you're going through distress when you're going through hardship and you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to relieve you you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to ease that hardship on you what should you say Look at this. لا إله إلا الله العظيم الحليم. There is no deity worthy of worship except Allah, العظيم, the magnificent, الحليم, the forbearing. لا إله إلا الله رب العرش العظيم. There is no deity worthy of worship except Allah, the Lord of the magnificent throne. لا إله إلا الله. There is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. رب السماوات, the Lord of the heavens. ورب الأرض, the Lord of the earth. ورب العرش الكريم, and the Lord of the glorious throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the generous throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the question here, Hamza, what did you request? You did not name a need. Even though you're distressed, even though you're desperate, you're going through a hardship. But yet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us on the tongue of His Messenger that if you engage in the praise of Allah and you engage in the best words which are beloved to Allah, which is the words of Tawheed, Allah knows your needs. Because Allah knows what you need. Allah knows what you need. You see, you don't need to name Allah ya'lamu sirra wa akhfa. Allah knows the secret and what before it becomes a secret. He knows that you need help in this area. He knows that you need fixing in this area. Now, if you engage in praising Him especially if you use the best words of praise, inshallah, Allah will address your needs bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. But like you mentioned, alhamdulillah, that you could do a combination of both, that you can begin always with the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then after that you name your need. There is no harm in this bi'idhnillahi ta'ala.
Which seems to be the pattern of qunut.
Anyway. Yeah.
Is there a specific dua that one should make during the month of Ramadan?
في سنن الترمذي وابن ماجه والنسائي بسند صحيح أمنا our mother عائشة رضي الله عن عائشة. May Allah be pleased with her.
Ameen.
Our mother Aisha. Wallahi, we love our mother Aisha so much. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with her, ya Rabbil Alameen. Radiallahu anha. She asked Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa hiya faqiha. Aisha is a learned wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She taught many predecessors this deen. Aisha radiallahu anha asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam one day, O Messenger of Allah, what should I make of a supplication if I'm given a hint, a feeling that this night is Laylatul Qadr? We said that the dua is accepted on this night, and I will explain why once we go over the second definition of the word Al-Qadr, why the dua is accepted on this night. But Aisha radiallahu anha is saying, what should I say, O Messenger of Allah? Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her, say, Allahumma, O Allah, innaka afuun. You are afu. And I'm sorry, I'm going to refrain from using English, because English has been unsuccessful in actually giving the word afu its proper meaning.
Okay.
And we're going to have to explain it. Innaka afu, you are afu. So afu is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-afu is one of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tuhibbu al-afwa, you love to make afu, to do afu, fa'afu anni. So the key word here is afu. What is the meaning of the word afu? Because it's a mistake to translate afu to be a forgiver.
Okay.
There is a difference between Ghafoor, because there is another name for Allah called Ghafoor. And you need to know that the name of Allah Al-Afu was mentioned in the Quran most of the time with the name of Allah Al-Ghafoor together. Afuun Ghafoor, Afuun Ghafoor, Afuun Ghafoor. So the fact they are mentioned together next to one another,
means
that means each one of them has its own meaning. What is the meaning of Al-Afu? For the brothers, so when you're making that supplication, Allahumma innaka afuun, tuhibbu al-afwa, fa'afu anni. Oh Allah, let's use the common English here, which is used in translating afu. Oh Allah, you are the pardoner.
Pardoning, okay.
You are the pardoning, the all-pardoning. You love to pardon, so pardon me. Now, what is the definition of the verb Al-Afu or Ya'fu, or the name of Allah Al-Afu, or the attribute of Allah Al-Afu? I will tell you a story, a short one, 1 minute story that will give you that meaning. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was migrating from Mecca to Medina, of course he was chased by the disbelievers and they were trying to kill him. So he hid in a cave on the top of a mountain, like the viewers know. And he had a plan that Asma radiallahu anha, the daughter of Abu Bakr, would bring him food with his sahabi, her father, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, inside the cave. So when Asma would come walking from her house in Mecca all the way to the cave, she of course leaves behind her traces. We're talking about sand and desert here.
Yeah.
And Arabs used to do that, used to trace a person through his feet. Fa'amir ibn Fuhayra, a freed slave of Abu Bakr, used to bring the food. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Amir, "U'fu athara asma," erase the feet or the printing of the traces of the feet of Asma. Consequently, we know what al-afu is to erase. You're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this night to erase your sin from the books, from your memory, from the memory of the people, from the memory of the angels.
So something that deals with Tawbah.
As if it did not exist.
So inshallah, we are going to come back and try to take some of your calls as well. Please join us back, and please don't hesitate to call. And really quick, the phone number is 720-222-0158. If you're calling from outside the United States, include 001. And we'll be back inshallah in after these messages. Ramadan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to our program, Ramadan Spirit America. We've been speaking about the subject of the night of decree, the night of power, Laylatul Qadr. And actually, we're going to go ahead and start our program by taking a call. So, caller, you are on the air right now. If you can hear me, go ahead and state your name and your question, and we'll go ahead and start with your question, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My name is Salahuddin. And I had a question, a little off topic, but I was trying to find out if I'm on medicine that right now I'm kind of wasting away. I've lost 20 pounds in less than a month. And I don't have money to feed anyone, so how can I make up for the fasting that I can do?
So, brother, you broke your fast because of illness, which is legitimate in Islam. But now you don't have the money to feed. That's your question.
Right, exactly.
Jazakallahu khair, brother Salahuddin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you cure.
Amen.
Our brother is asking, of course he is sick. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. If you are sick or not resident, not being a resident, a traveler, then you can make up the days later. But if you have a chronic disease, so we forgot to ask Brother Salah Uddin whether his illness is terminal illness based on the instruction from the... are you still there, Brother Salah Uddin?
Is
it chronic illness?
Yes, it's chronic.
Okay, it's a chronic illness. Then the fidya, then feeding for each day out of the month, one miskeen is the expiation for this. But now Brother Salahuddin is bringing up another issue that he does not have the money. Himself is needy. So this amount of money which you owe, so $10, living in the United States of America, and I hope I'm talking to you, you're living there, $10 per day, that's the average amount of a meal we spend here in the United States of America to have a meal, an average meal, $10. So $10 for each day, that would make what? Times 29 or 30 is what?
$390.
$300. So now what you need to do, Brother Salahuddin, is to keep track of these amounts every year. You add 300, 300, 300, 300. As long as you're still within the status that you still need, you cannot afford to pay that money, you don't have to pay it because you don't have the money. Anyways, listata'a is missing. You know, for you to fulfill any of the commands in Islam, you must be able to, whether able physically or able financially. You're unable financially. But what if you become able? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would pour wealth. We ask Allah to give you, Ya Rabbil Alameen, in abundance upon you. Then you know how much you owe, then you need to pay it. So it's a debt. You pay it once you're able to. If you happen, may Allah give you a long life with faith, with iman. If you happen to leave before becoming able, Allah would pardon you bi-idhnillahi ta'ala.
So that actually, it reminds me of another question. I know this is a very common question, but I've heard different responses to it. Women who are pregnant, I've heard that some people say all they do is they pay the fidya, and I've heard other opinions where they make up and pay the fidya. What is your preference?
It's one of the most complicated questions once it comes to fasting.
Sure, because even Ibn Abbas had a view, I heard, that was fidya.
Yes. You see, yani, this is where I hold my opinion, myself personally, as a little student of knowledge. The subject is related to another subject. What is the other subject? The ruling regarding birth control in Islam.
So the pregnancy is attributed to... Actually, we have another caller,
okay.
So I want to be fair to the callers. Callers, or caller, go ahead, state your name and your question and where you're calling from as well, please.
This is Abdul Hakim from New York.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. عبد الحكيم from New York.
ما شاء الله.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. So my question is, with Ramadan coming down to about 7 days, what can we start doing during Ramadan in these last 7 days to start preparing for that post-Ramadan letdown?
That's a very good question.
Very good question.
Yeah, this is a big issue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the ibadah, his worship, so easy in the month of Ramadan. Mm-hmm. Shayateen are chained. People are encouraged. The masajid are filled.
Yeah.
Tahajjud today in Dar al-Tawheed, mashallah, yani, I was looking at this. So, this is the first year.
Yeah.
You know, we have even salah on it. And alhamdulillah, hada min fadlillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the masses are there. And normally people are attracted to masses. When they see, you know, people are in the masajid, they're more attracted to the masajid. So the ibadah is made so easy during that month. Subhanallah. Also, the fasting helps that your nafs is not as demanding as it is when it's being given food and water and so forth. So now what happens after Ramadan, this is the drop. The shayateen are released. The people normally are not as many as of them in the masajid like during Ramadan. Now, how to prepare for it? Follow the sunnah. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم told us that من صام رمضان, whoever fast رمضان, ثم أتبعه بست من شوال, then he follows it with 6 days from شوال as if he fasted the whole month. So now, instead of you abandoning fasting completely, what about observing these 6 days of شوال, and you're going to end up Britain fasting the whole year?
Yeah.
We have Mondays and Thursdays. That's fasting you still can do. We have the 13th, the 13th, the 14th, the 15th, or in general, 3 days out of each month, or the three wide days. Mm-hmm. Salah is not over yet. You can still pray tahajjud at night. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, أفضل الصلاة بعد الفريضة صلاة الليل. The most beloved salah after the mandatory salah is the salah that you observe at night when people are asleep. تتجافى جنوبهم عن المضاجع يدعون ربهم خوفا وطمعا ومما رزقناهم ينفقون. So this is the attribute and the quality of the people of Ihsan. So follow the sunnah in maintaining some practices. It doesn't have to be at the same level or the same magnitude. You can go down a little bit, but don't allow yourself to drop totally because as if you have not accomplished anything. Because the people normally ask this question, what is the sign that my act was accepted? You know, the first sign, how you are after and how you are before. Mm-hmm. Just compare the two. If you are in a better condition with respect to your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that means you have come up with an accepted act bi-idhnillahi ta'ala.
So if we progress. So if we pray Qiyam after the month of Ramadan, is it just as good to pray in the last third of the night as it is after Isha?
Well, Salatul Layl in general, the Salah that you observe at night in general, from after Isha until Fajr time.
So the whole
best time is the last third of the night, because this is when Allah descends in a way that suits His Majesty.
Yes.
And that is when, you know, the dua is preferred. But if you know that you can do it and it's difficult, then you can go ahead and do it, you know, after midnight or whenever, inshallah. Cool. I want to go to two things here before, because we had the viewers hanging. The second definition of al-qadr.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And also you ask a question about the pregnant and the breastfeeding. The pregnant and the breastfeeding, in my opinion, is really connected to the ruling regarding birth control in Islam. Can you have birth control in Islam? Yes, you can. During the time when you're breastfeeding, not you, Hamza, but the women, okay? I'm trying to make you smile. Yeah, inshallah. So not during the time of breastfeeding. Or if there is an imminent danger on the health of the mom.
Okay.
Like sisters who deliver with C-section. You know that they have certain number of deliveries. After that, the doctor tells them your stomach cannot hold a baby.
Yeah.
So consequently, they can use birth control. Other than that, women have to what? Keep going.
Even if they're pregnant?
What do you mean pregnant?
Pregnant during the month of Ramadan. Like,
no, what I mean is they are pregnant, they breastfeed, then they get pregnant again, then they breastfeed, then they get pregnant again.
Oh, you're talking about making up the day, okay.
Because this is the ruling regarding birth control. I'm talking about birth control. What is the you see, you should not be preventing the birth of children. That's the ruling I'm talking about. That's the view of the majority of the jurists regarding the subject. Unless there is imminent danger on the life of the mother or during the duration of time when you breastfeeding, the 2 years. وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ The breastfeeding period duration based on that verse in Surah Al-Baqarah is two years.
Okay.
Now, if a sister who calls you, someone who has sticking to that ruling, that inshallah, I'm going to get pregnant, I'm going to deliver breastfeed, then I'm going to get pregnant again, then breastfeed, then technically, this sister has no time to make up the fast.
Yeah.
Technically. Because every pregnancy, she's going to be missing almost 3 Ramadan.
Yep.
1 for the pregnancy and 2 for the breastfeeding. Of course, if she's eligible to break fast while pregnant or while breastfeeding, because not every pregnant, not every breastfeeding qualifies to break her fast. The inability must be a condition for them to qualify to break their fast. But let's say that they broke their fast each pregnancy, 3 months, 90 days. Let's say that she's going to have 10 babies. 12 babies. Some sisters, wallahi,
it's a lot of fasting. Yeah,
so how many? There is no way you're going to make up the days. This is where Ibn Abbas, Ibn Umar, and this is the view adopted by Sheikh Al-Albani, rahmahullah, as well, saying what? Go ahead and make the fidya. But if the sister of that type, no, I got to keep up with my figure, I don't want to lose weight, and so forth, then the sister has to make up the days, inshallah.
If she has, okay. So we do have another caller, and caller, if you can hear us, go ahead and state your name. Where you're calling from and your question, inshallah.
My name is Shakur from Texas.
Okay, assalamu alaikum.
My question is, what is the difference between zakat al mal and the sadaqa?
No, jazakallahu khaira. Okay, the difference between zakat al fitr. Zakat al fitr, the word al fitr indicates Ramadan, that you're fasting and you're going to break your fast. So zakatul fitr is a portion or amount of food that you give out to the needy towards the end of the month of Ramadan, right before you're about to break your fast. The time, the end time or the limit here before the imam stands up to lead the salah, salatul Eid.
Is there a start time or can you do it anytime?
The start time is the last 2 nights.
Okay.
The best time actually is right before Salatul Eid. But now, because of the logistics, you can start early.
Okay.
So that you allow, especially if you are not going to disperse it yourself, if you're going to put it in the hands of people or organizations or masajid or institutions, then allow the institutions to pay it, to disperse it. So allow them time. So you can start actually the last 10 nights of the month. Yeah. But beginning with the 25th is ideal. The 25th, 26th is ideal. So zakatul fitr. What is the purpose of the zakatul fitr? The wisdom behind it. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم فرض رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حديث عبد الله بن عمر. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mandated upon every individual, every Muslim, not just fasting, every Muslim, even if he's not fasting, even if he's exempt, even children who do not qualify to fast because of age, you still have to pay zakat on them, and this is upon the head of the household. طُعْمَ لِلْمَسَاكِينَ to feed the masakeen, وَمَطْهَرَةٌ لِلصَّائِمِ مِنَ الرَّفَثِ أَوْ مِنَ اللَّغُ, and it will purify the fasting of the fasting person from the nonsense and all these things that we get engaged on while we're fasting. هذا زكاةُ الفطر. زكاةُ المال is the 2.5% of the wealth saved for a whole lunar year, provided that it reached a minimum amount. That amount is measured by silver. That amount would buy you 595 grams of silver.
Okay.
Or 85 grams of gold. You can pick and choose which variable you want to use to measure your wealth with.
Okay.
Now, if you have that minimum or more,
for a whole lunar year, mm-hmm. not Gregorian, you have to pay 2.5% out of this.
Okay.
To the poor and the needy and the other eight places where the verse in Surah At-Tawbah instructed us to place Zakatul Fitr, Zakatul Mal, I'm sorry, at. So this is Zakatul Mal. Sadaqah are donations.
Mm-hmm.
What is known to be donations is, you know, extra. It's like you pray five times a day and you pray 12 rak'ahs, nafila a day,
sure.
like the salah. That you make hajj. The mandatory hajj, it's mandatory upon you once in a lifetime, and you go back and perform hajj again. So sadaqah is an increase. And this is recommended especially in the month of Ramadan. And we had a whole show, me and yourself, yeah, I believe, about zakah, that the Rasulullah used to be the most generous of all people, mm-hmm. and his generosity would increase in Ramadan. Okay. So you should not stick to the mandatory only. You should do more in Ramadan, following the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam.
And so when it comes to people who are paying fidya, is it only among the Muslims that they are feeding, or can it be anybody in the community, you know, among the people of the book, or?
Well, first of all, we have to agree masakeen.
Sure.
This is number one. The priority is the Muslims.
Okay.
We should fulfill the needs of our Muslim masakeen, and we do have a lot of those.
Yes, we do.
So if you're have fulfilled the needs of the masakeen locally, then you look for the masakeen. Look at our refugees and brothers in Syria. Look at Syria.
Yeah.
Syria is a drama. Look at Burma. What's yeah. happening to the Muslims in Burma? We don't talk about this, unfortunately. Look at our brothers in countries like Iraq.
Yeah.
Look at our brothers in countries like Somal, but I think it's getting better, alhamdulillah, there. But in countries like Palestine, for example, Gaza, yeah. for example, Gaza, for example, these places, they need our help, and we need to fulfill. After yeah. that, if we fulfill the needs of those, we can do this, inshallah.
And we do have another call. Caller, if you can hear me, go ahead and state your name, where you're calling from, and your question, please.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My name is Khalid. I'm calling from Atlanta, Georgia.
MashaAllah, brother Khalid is a regular caller, MashaAllah.
Yes.
Actually, I would like to have a special request from the Sheikh. I've been following for a long time. So if I can have his personal number, I would appreciate there are some call which I want to personally call him.
Yeah, you can take it from the control, inshallah.
Increase his knowledge.
You can take it from the control, inshallah. Control room, inshallah, later on, inshallah.
Thank you very much.
Jazakallah khair.
My first question is about this niyyah. When I was growing up, they would write it, we have to memorize it and say it. And later on, they told us, no, you have to, it's from the heart. And now also they say it's not from the heart, it's when it comes to your mind, like you want to pray Zuhur. And that is, so when you go to the prayer, you don't have to do anything, just say Allahu Akbar. So I want the Sheikh to put some light on this and tell me the right way so that I will have some ease on this issue.
Jazakallah.
That's one.
Now.
The second one is about Salatul Witr. You see, this in Ramadan, we always pray the Witr, the Taraweeh and the Witr together. So, but there's an hadith saying that if you follow the Imam to the end, you will get a reward as if you were praying the whole night. So in a case now, this last 10, we pray the tahajjud. So the Imam say, okay, those who want to pray tahajjud shouldn't pray the witr. Wait, but the same Imam who is going to lead the tahajjud, but he prayed the witr, he led the witr in the taraweeh. But he's telling the ma'mun, those who are going to pray the witr those who are going to pray tahajjud should delay their witr. So in this case, if you leave, are you going to get the reward as the hadith says, or you have to ignore him and follow him to the end, then in the tahajjud, then you don't have to pray the witr again? So that's my second question.
Okay, as for the, let's begin with the second question because it's a little bit problematic in a lot of masajid,
yeah.
especially in America here. Let's begin with it. the fact that the last 10 nights of the month, of course, the brother quoted a hadith that, yes, whoever prays with the imam until he concludes his salah, he will leave forgiven. Not pray the whole night. Maybe there is a wording that I'm not aware of, but the wording that he will, Allah will forgive his sins. Now, during the last 10 nights of the month, the introduction of the Hajjud. Now, we're banned from observing two witr at one night. لا وترانِ في ليلة. You should not observe two witr in one night. So now, a lot of the brothers, they say, okay, we're going to come for Taraweeh, but we're not going to come back for Tahajjud. So now the imam is really puzzled with the idea. Really, the ideal solution, dear imams, if you're watching, is just delay the witr until the last night, the last salah that you, which is Tahajjud, before Fajr. Just skip the witr at the beginning of the night. And this way, the people who are coming back, they're going to come back with you. And the people who want to get the virtue of being with the imam until the imam concludes the salah, would conclude the salah with you. And they can go home, or even in the masjid, they can stay and pray their witr and leave if they are, if they don't plan to go. And so this is the solution out of the problem.
So concluding the salah does not necessarily mean completing witr. As long as they finish with him at
with
that
him.
Point.
Okay. Yes, at this point, okay. Yes. Okay. And then they can pray by themselves. If they're not planning to pray again later on the night, they're with Shaf and Witr, and then basically they are done this way.
Okay.
But now with these issues here, you know, we end up with a lot of issues, but this is really the solution for the issue. But dear brother, inshallah, follow the imam and do one Witr with him and not do the other. And if you happen to do the other with the imam, and you done one witr, there is a way to adjust this, that when he says, Salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, Salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, you stand up and you pray one more rak'ah. Okay. So this way you ended up turning the odd to even number. So it's no longer witr. I hope, you know, I'm not confusing, but this is the solution.
Okay.
The issue of the intention, the issue of the intention. What is the definition of intention? The scholars define intention to be النية هي عزم القلب على فعل الشيء, that you resolve in your heart to do something. So consequently now, the intention is the act of the heart.
Alone.
Alone.
Even for Umrah, though, Umrah has
Hajj and Umrah, again a lot of the scholars, they call, a lot of the brothers, they say this is intention. No.
No.
You know, when you say labbaik Allahumma umrah, there is not an intention.
Okay, so
it equals to Allahu Akbar in the salah.
That makes okay.
You understand, but yeah, you already have an intention to perform umrah. You've been traveling for years.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, it's actually a mistake in my opinion, and I know a lot of I used to say that before. I said that before.
Yeah.
If you actually go back to my old talks, but really, if you think about it, you already intended to go and perform umrah. You booked a ticket. You send your passport to a travel agent. You paid for it.
Yeah.
That's all in practical application of the intention.
Sure.
But now when you go into the miqat, the place where you're supposed to begin, initiate your umrah, as if you say Allahu Akbar, that means what? You entered into salah. You say labbaik Allahumma umrah, as if you have entered into the state of ihram.
Okay.
Ah. No.
So the intention is just...
So basically, my brother Khalid from Atlanta, you see, I think the way that we're looking at that subject of intention, that we're making it humongous. Intention is a thought that occurred in your heart. And when we say heart, we really mean mind. Because we believe as Muslims that your intellect is in your heart. We believe that. That we think with our heart. The spiritual aspect of the thoughts are in the heart. So just the thought that you're going to the masjid to pray dhuhr, this is the intention, but you don't have to articulate it.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
okay, so back to the issue of Laylatul Qadr.
Al-Qadr. Okay. The other definition of the word Al-Qadr or Al-Qadr is related to the sixth article of faith, which is what? The subject of Al-Qadr. And this is a very controversial, like you mentioned, subject. First of all, it's not easy to explain. That's why you don't find a lot of people, students of knowledge, talking about it. Because the subject is completely related to the names and the attributes of Allah. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people find discomfort there because you really have to be good with that field. Not every person is good with that field.
Sure.
So when you're not well-versed with the subject of the names and the attributes of Allah, consequently, you're not going to be able to talk about the subject of al-Qadr. But al-Qadr means the ordainment or the predestination or the divine destiny, that everything is already, Allah knew it, Allah wrote it, Allah willed it to happen, and Allah created us to fulfill it. Now, on Laylatul Qadr, the annual destiny of every individual is written, every Muslim is written. And it's taken, extracted from the preserved tablet.
Sure.
So the knowledge of the preserved tablet is with Allah. Allah would pass on these records to the angels.
Okay.
And this is why the dua is accepted on this night, because if you make dua, your qadr can be edited. But remember, Allah knew already that you're going to make dua, and this is already recorded in the preserved tablet.
And I would encourage our viewers.
يَمْحُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثْبِتْ وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ.
Sure. And I would encourage our viewers, actually, if you want to get more details on the subject of qadr, to watch Imam Karim Abu Zayd's videos. He has a whole series on it. He's the Imam of Dar Tawheed. So look up that organization as well. We're going to go ahead and wrap things up. We do thank you for joining us this time for Ramadan Spirit America. Once again, I'm your host, Hamza Popal, and we wish you the best for these last nights of Ramadan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
In it the Quran was revealed to Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon his soul. Ramadan, 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 Ramadan.